I'd like to introduce Nina Power and Dr. Victoria Browne. It's a wonderful thing.
She's also a doctor.
I don't really care.
We were just talking about that, but I mean, we want Dr. to introduce their doctor title. So,
don't blame me.
Doctor. So it's a wonderful thing that they're here. And I'd just very quickly like to thank London Creative Network SPACE for hosting this event, and also Arts Council England for their kind support in helping me allow this to happen. Just very quickly to give you a bit of background to Nina and to Victoria, and also how this has come about. Nina is the author of a book that I read, which I absolutely loved. It's called One Dimensional Woman. And there's a short quote from that. She says that the height of supposed female emancipation coincides so perfectly with consumerism. It's a miserable index of a politically desolate time, and that we have the human capacity for transformation in work, sexuality, and culture that, while seemingly far-fetched in the current ideological climate, may provide more serious material for a feminism of the future. And it was this idea of the future that of why we wanted to have this talk. And Victoria, she's the author of the book Feminism, Time and Nonlinear History. And in her book, which I'm oversimplifying, she calls for an approach to history that's multi-layered and interdisciplinary. And she talks about how our notion of history shapes our lives and the way we think about history. The way we think about history shapes the way that we think about feminism. And they both explore ideas of how not to repeat the same old patterns and how to build alternative models. So, in my mind, very perfect conversational partners. And just a very quick sort of background to the project that I'm working on. I've been trying to make a history painting about the near future, and. So that's a good idea, and then I realised I shouldn't do what an enormous and possibly ridiculous task I had set myself. Traditionally, history painting is a show of skill, loaded with highbrow messages. It's a key event, a moment in time, and captured. And it's often used as propaganda and in service of state and empire. But I want to build a history painting that's the voice of the people, or those without governing power. And in this instance, it's come down to historically women. I've tried to get to an imagined future, and it's devastated by right-wing ideology and corporate war. And to create a sense of realism, I've been collaging together ideas and images from the past and stuff that's happening now. So you can see some of my work here. It's a work in progress. And it's images from Renaissance statues to tiny little insect-shaped drones that are from a CIA Flickr account. And I've simply mirrored and exaggerated existing social structures. Ending up with a very long canvas on a wall which has got no women in it, so I've questionably and inadvertently created a grand narrative that could be read as a patriarchal, if not wonky, timeline of cause or effect, and a group of women that's growing, and they're freestanding, and they perform off the wall, almost following traditions of female visual art practice since the 70s. I would like them at some point to become possibly a multi-directional timeline, but there's a lot more work to go with that. I asked Nina and Victoria to just help me with a bit of thinking about this project. So the brief literally was history, the near future, non-linear time, and feminism. I think they are. In this project, I kept thinking, well, you know, this is a very sort of male world, and it's not a world that I would have built or that women would have built. And that's just where I'd like to start. And what kind of world would we build? You know, where do you see our world going in the future?
All right. Just
a little task.
I think I was going to speak for a bit. I'm not sure how long you sort of want to speak for.
15, 20 minutes, and then.
Okay.
But if at any point you want to talk my questions at the end, unless it's really burning desire to put your hand up.
Yeah, okay. I mean, I've got a short thing that I wanted to maybe start with, which is, I guess, on the concept of utopia, and specifically Thomas More's utopia, particularly in relation to thinking about like feminist utopias. So it's not, it's kind of, it is related to the question of temporality and the future, but I suppose it's thinking about more I guess theoretically or literarily about images of what that might mean, I suppose. Mm-hmm. And because I think that's part of the question really. It's kind of, there's this stumbling block about how do we even begin to think about not just alternative histories, but alternative futures or even the present, because, you know, things are so heavy in a certain sense. You know, it's hard to imagine how things could have been otherwise, I suppose. So it's a particular kind of tense, you know, when we think about like the future perfect, you know, like, you know, it will have been, right? But there's also this kind of negative version of that, right? We can't necessarily, I don't know, we can't imagine how things could have been other than what they were in a certain way. You know, I don't know. Complicated. But, anyway, well, thank you for inviting me to speak, and I'm very happy to speak with Victoria, whose work I admire a lot. And yeah, so what I think I'm going to do is read out the first bit on Thomas More and Utopia, and then just speak more freely about what I think some of the issues around time are now, and who owns time,
ooh,
basically. Might be a bit more like speculative at the end. Well, I'm speculative. I'm a philosopher. I can't really do anything else. Okay, so in More's Utopia, which celebrated its 500th birthday last year, we were invited to think about what communism might look like. Okay, so it's a kind of, you know, it is a book about communism, and obviously, really, our idea of utopia in a sense is kind of hugely shaped by Thomas More. But this is a communism that includes slavery, the use of mercenaries in war, and the death penalty for adultery. This is communism in the pre-Marxist sense, where resources and work are equally shared, where money, poverty and private property has been abolished, and where the life of the mind is heralded as the pinnacle of human existence. It's a curiously platonic kind of communism, where toilet pots are made of gold. So little do the inhabitants of Utopia care for it, so they keep their gold in their toilets, as in toilets. And people get up before dawn to attend lectures. like today, in fact. In this austere world, people are nevertheless generous, healthy and happy. No one is poor there, writes More. There are no beggars, and though no one owns anything, everyone is rich. But like all places that exist precisely nowhere, it's not clear how we are to take More's proposal, as whimsy, a serious suggestion, or a satire. We need a way into his curious commonwealth, the perspective that cuts through and reveals the distance, not only between More's time 500 years ago and ours, but between More's ideas and the world in which he wrote them. Thinking specifically about the role of women in More's utopia, their position then and their position now, allows us to shine a light on these distances and to think about what a true feminist utopia might look like. What would a world where women were not defined by men be? Or where women are not defined by men? Put were in sort of, yeah, again, this problem of tenses, where women are not defined by men. In a sense, this is one of the hardest things to imagine because there are so few resources for it, and I suppose that's my starting point. When Simone de Beauvoir declared women to be the second sex, she wanted it to be understood that women have never been able to position themselves, you know, in an autonomous way, in a kind of, self-standing or freestanding way, because, you know, this kind of historical implication, the kind of constant separating off of women from one another through patriarchy and pre-patriarchy. Because in a sense, that possibility has always been closed off. Women are property, their reproductive capacities are policed, their sexuality is judged to be too much or too little, their education is granted grudgingly. And think about, we were just mentioned Wollstonecraft earlier, and you know, this idea of precisely, you know, and it's a very interesting way Wollstonecraft puts it, where she says, look, it's a kind of wager, it's a kind of bet. She says, if we really are, you know, crap, if we really are like frivolous, stupid beings, then give us education, and if we are like that, we'll fail. You know, she puts it in the form of a challenge or a bet, and it's so interesting that this is a kind of rhetorical device. You know, how do we trick history, or how do we say, you know, you know, play off history against itself. You know, I'm very interested in this as a kind of tactic. You know, so their education is granted grudgingly and is still not granted at all in some places. What it might mean to be a woman is yet unknown, even now, 500 years after Moore. So what does Moore, or rather his explorer, Hyphlidae, I don't know how you pronounce it, but it's a kind of made-up Greek name, which means nonsense peddler, he's the explorer of the island in Moore's book. So what does he say about the women of Utopia? Every woman is a worker, and each is taught a trade. The women are taught the lighter crafts described in the book, such as working with wool and linen. Both men and women farm, and both are educated. The sexes are equally and vigorously trained for war, though most of the time the Utopians prefer to pay mercenaries to do their dirty work. Women can also attend the early morning lectures. So far, so egalitarian. On the other hand, it is the women in the book who move to their husbands' households when they marry. So the question of kin and the role of women in kind of kinship relations as a, you know, kind of form of property and exchange. And they act as servants, to use Moore's word, to their husbands. They are also primarily responsible for childcare and cooking, on top of the labour they do, a scenario that seems curiously familiar. Though in Utopia, capital U, the labour part is never too onerous or lengthy, as there is no need to work more to provide more than is necessary, hence the kind of austere, very minimal image of the world. So as well as the double burden, women are perceived also to be weaker. On the odd trip out of the city, for which permission is needed, if women are present, then a public slave, using Moore's words, who drives the oxen-powered wagon is used. But groups of men alone simply dispense with the transport and go by foot. In intimate matters, premarital sex is banned, and both men and women are brutally punished for it. A strangely explicit ceremony nonetheless takes place before the wedding day, where, quote, whether she be widow or virgin, the woman is shown naked before their betrothed, the men are too, as well. As Moore puts it, when men go to buy a colt, where they are risking only a little money, they are so cautious that, though the animal is almost bare, they won't close the deal until saddle and blanket have been taken off, lest there be a hidden sore underneath. no one, not even the kindest utopian, wants a woman with syphilis. That's too early for this. Okay, very occasionally, women are allowed to become priests of their heterodox panpsychist religion, but only a widow of advanced years is ever chosen. It doesn't happen often. So Moore's mixture of Platonic, Aristotelian, and humanist ideas construct a commonwealth that is fair but differentiated. Women can work, fight, and learn, but they are still weaker and must orient themselves towards the domestic and act as servants to their husbands. Nevertheless, in some respects, Moore's vision is more progressive than today, where women's education is still seen as secondary in some countries. Women are barred from certain military duties, but I think everyone should be barred from all military duties, and are still not allowed to be priests in the Catholic and many other faiths. But there are some equalities worth fighting for more than others, perhaps. At the end of the book, Moore, the narrator, in conversation with his own narrator, Hyphliday, suggests that there is a single reason that non-utopians, that is to say us, the readers, have failed to follow in their footsteps. Pride. Pride is described by Moore as, quote, measuring her prosperity not by what she has, but by what others lack. Pride is a serpent from hell that twines itself around the hearts of men, acting like a suckfish. But is it merely convention to gender sins in this way? And why is it that pride is a woman? Why are the men of earthly commonwealths held back by feminized sin? And we can obviously think about this in relation to the Bible and many other myths and narratives about where sin resides. Must men always blame women for their worst excesses? And I think this is kind of interesting to think about in terms of, you know, maybe it seems tangential, but some of the debates around kind of visual images, particularly around selfies, and this question of narcissism, where, you know, in a sense, the entirety of our history is kind of, you know, men, you know, using images of women to kind of reflect back their own desires, but the moment kind of women do it themselves, it's somehow, you know, this, you know, monstrous, narcissistic thing. So what utopia, then, can we imagine if our no place, which is what the word means, was understood from the standpoint of women,
and not just as the sex defined always in relation to men. Would the men disappear, as they almost do in Charlotte Perkins Gilman's 1915 Her Land, which is, you know, in a sense, problematic in many ways, but attempt to think about a world without men, if you like. What would it mean to have a kind of feminist, entirely female utopia? Or would we imagine taking equality to extremes and levelling the biological playing fields via technology, outsourcing birth to machines, and freeing women from the labour of reproduction, like Shulamith Firestone's 1970 techno-futurist vision in The Dialectic of Sex, you know, where she makes this, you know, I guess now quite familiar argument that, in a sense, sex class comes before economic class, you know. So she's trying to say that Marx and Engels are kind of right, and Freud is kind of right, but they don't go deep enough, that actually the fundamental kind of split in the entirety of human history is the unequal biological relationship between men and women, and that it's technology that will level the playing field, to use that phrase. And there's a kind of ambivalence in the book between whether it's the technology that will kind of inaugurate a social revolution, or whether you need a kind of social revolution first for the technology to be kind of purposed in this way. I mean, I'm very critical of Firestone's book, as many people are, but I think we have to kind of acknowledge it as a sort of arising speculative thought, you know, a way of thinking about the future and, you know, the role of technology. And some of these debates are obviously very pertinent, you know. I mean, there are always kind of debates around, you know, artificial wombs, but even before that, I mean, reproductive technology in terms of IVF and the pill, you know, have changed things fundamentally for many people, many women. And I think it's interesting to ask kind of difficult questions about how they have, and you know, how can we have a kind of dialectical or balanced understanding of what those technologies have allowed and what they might mean for the future, I suppose. I just wanted to mention that as another kind of, image of techno-futurism, I suppose. Would it simply be to imagine the possibility of women defining themselves as existential subjects, so thinking about what a sort of kind of purely sort of female-defined future might be, condemned to be free by the human condition, but not trapped in unfreedom by the patriarchy? And this is what de Beauvoir really ends up, the position she ends up with in The Second Sex, is a kind of, you know, the book is a kind of increasingly angry and amazing history. You know, she looks at history, myth, religion, psychoanalysis, Marxism, and they're all kind of, they all fail to grasp, in a sense, the specificity of the way in which women are othered constantly, you know, and our positions as the second sex. But in a way, her solution, if you like, is to imagine this kind of self-grounding, this kind of, existential freedom of being condemned to be free, you know, without those kind of shackles, without the sort of shackles of history, you know. And that's her image of the future, in a way, even though she's very critical of Sartre for kind of presupposing, you know, a certain kind of freedom that actually isn't there. And we could also look at Frantz Fanon's work, you know, as a way of thinking about the limitations, I suppose, of a too neutral, a too naive image of existential freedom, you know, because the point is, you don't always get to define your projects, you don't always get to define who you are. If you're constantly being positioned and treated in a certain way on the basis of sex and race, you don't get to have the same kind of freedom to determine yourself, you know, and that's the point. So I guess in a more materialist, more limited sense, you know, it's not utopian in the same way as Firestone, but what would it mean to actually, you know, really have that kind of freedom? And it's almost like the freedom to be uncertain, actually. It's the freedom to almost be, to fail and to be unhappy, in a way. And I'm quite interested in this. I'm very interested in a kind of feminism of failure and kind of being rubbish. And I suppose you mentioned the book I wrote a long time ago, when I was quite a lot younger. I mean, part of the reason I wrote that book was actually in response to, it's not really a book, it's like a pamphlet, in response to this kind of very, I found very irritating positive narrative, you know, of kind of mainstream feminism. It's like, yay, everything's great, you know, empowerment, yay, things are brilliant, you know, and you can see that reflected, I guess, in the kind of lean-in idea, like the, you know, the corporate feminism idea that, you know, participation is wonderful. Yes, you have to try a bit harder, but, you know, capitalism is great for women. And it's like, no, it's fucking not, it's awful. And so I'm quite interested in, yeah, this idea of not succeeding and what a feminism failure looks like. Anyway, okay, so I can imagine certain things about thinking about kind of feminist utopian, feminist future. What would it be like if traits that get associated with women, such as emotion and care, were not slandered and poorly paid, if paid at all, but aspirations for all humanity, such that to be associated with these qualities would be the greatest thing and a source of great pride, not in the negative sense. I can imagine a world where the male gaze is not the sole filter for the visual, where people are granted other qualities beyond their hotness or otherwise. I can imagine a world in which reparations are made for the way in which women have been treated, though what form this would take, I cannot imagine, especially if we, like, more abolish money. But it's interesting to think back to something like the Wages for Housework campaign, where, in a sense, there is a kind of provocative and, again, a sort of wager, you know, saying, look, you know, we want reparations, we want to be paid in full, we want it now, we want all the, you know, all the money that we were never paid for all the work we did on the basis of gender, on the basis of this idea that you must do these things because you're a woman and women care and women love and, you know, this is women's role. And so there's something, again, very provocative about this call and this demand, actually, for reparations. And we can also think about this in relation to race as well. But perhaps women should be paid back. You know, this is a kind of question. And then how would we kind of get reparations for patriarchy? And so, yeah, I think a true feminist utopia, maybe a hertopia, would surely not have slaves or wars, but I think it would not be boring either. It would be rather constantly inventive. And I think one of the criticisms is always levelled at sort of some feminist utopias is like, but where's the innovation? Where's the drama? Yeah, where's the drama? It's like, you know, you're always accusing women of being dramatic, but, you know, like wars, man. It's like mad drama. Anyway, of course it makes us sound awesome. Just finished, I'm talking too much, but on this point of time, I suppose what I want to say is I've been thinking a lot in the past few years, and it's sort of related, it relates to kind of questions of patriarchy and the way men relate to one another, is through the state and through using time as a form of punishment. And if you think about, you know, prison in the most kind of basic sense, you know, what is it? Well, it's based on the idea that, you know, your life is finite and that someone else has the power to take away a chunk of your finite life away from you, you know, and it's precisely predicated on a certain image of vulnerability in a way, but that's never kind of discussed in that way. You know, it's always discussed in terms of punishment, you know, that there is this power that punishes you for something that you've done. But behind that is this, I think, very weaponized image of time. You know, and who has the capacity to control time? Well, it's the state. You know, and I, you know, it's courts, it's waiting for a trial, it's being on bail, it's being in prison, it's being punished after that. It's also being held in, like, refugee centres, you know, where the sense of time is something like a profound limbo, you know, where you have no control over time, you have no kind of relation, you can't possibilize or have a relation to the future because your status is so uncertain, you know, both spatially and temporally, you know, when you're being held for indefinite periods of time. And I think indefinite detention is kind of one of the core ideas we need to think about if we're going to have a politics of time now. What does it mean for people to be suspended by powers beyond their control, that, you know, powers that have the force of violence behind them? So I suppose, yeah, if we're thinking about time as such, I would always want to begin from who has this question of who has time taken away from them, you know, and by who, you know, and I think only then can we proceed to speculate about more positive relations to time. So that's what I want to say.
Yes, please.
And then we talk.
So thanks for that, Nina.
Yeah, that's really
Sorry, I'm a bit surreal. I've been awake, but I was like playing spell last night till really late.
Yeah.
And I'm really out of it. And it's kind of weird to do a talk in this Saturday morning.
It's holding to time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Victoria. So yeah, and thank you to Laura for inviting me. It's lovely to speak with Nina. So what I think probably I've been conscripted in the project to do is maybe talk a little bit more about the idea of linear and non-linear history. So I'm going to just say a little bit about that in relation to my research, which is looking at the idea of linear and non-linear history in relation to the history of feminism. So I'm not a historian, so I'm not interested in constructing historical narratives. What I'm interested in doing is looking at the kinds of temporal structures that exist when historical narratives of feminism are constructed. So I think I can trace my interest in this back to a conversation I had quite a few years ago with a friend, and we were kind of catching up, you know, what are you doing? What are you doing with your life? And I was saying that I wanted to do a PhD in feminist philosophy, but I couldn't think of a specific topic. And so she said, you know, well, what's happening in feminism these days? Where's feminism at? Which I found to be an impossible question. To answer. And I didn't really know what it meant. You know, does it mean where is feminism kind of today in comparison to where it's been in the past? Does it mean, you know, what has feminism kind of fulfilled the promises or goals that it's set for itself? And if that is what it means, how on earth would we be able to judge or measure that? Is feminism, is there this kind of unified or essential or continuous thing called feminism that kind of persists through time? So my answer to the last question was a resounding no. So it seemed quite clear to me then that feminism needs to kind of conceive or represent its own history in non-linear terms. But actually, it doesn't usually do this. Usually, or the most common way of thinking about the history of feminism is through a model of feminist waves. So when I started thinking, you know, what does this wave metaphor, or wave narrative, what are the kind of temporal logics behind that? And on the face of it, you could say that the wave metaphor feels quite promising for thinking about history in a non-linear way. But certainly when I think of the sea, I think of, you know, multiple waves crashing and ebbing and flowing, you know, different waves kind of doing their own thing at the same time. So you could say that the metaphor of waves is quite conducive to thinking about the history of feminism in a non-linear way. But actually that's not usually how the metaphor is deployed. So ordinarily within the model of feminist waves, you have first wave feminism that comes first, and is committed to, or is kind of centered around campaigns for rights as a solution to gender-based oppression. And it's usually used to denote feminist campaigns for suffrage, so particularly in the late, in the 19th and early 20th centuries. Then you have the second wave, which is associated with women's liberation movements. 60s and 70s, and feminisms that take a Marxist or radical approach. Then the third wave was supposed to start in the 1990s and is associated with a postmodern approach, so with a kind of embrace of pluralism and rejection of grand theories of patriarchy and capitalism and so on. Some people do speak of a fourth wave or even a fifth wave of feminism. I'm never quite sure what these are, but I suppose the point is that whatever the detail of these kind of wave narratives, and however many waves might be included, they consistently construct the history of feminism as a kind of singular, progressive, linear journey through time, past to present to future. So what's wrong with this model, or what's wrong with this kind of linear narrative of history? quite a lot. I'll just kind of make a couple of points. One is that I think it reproduces a kind of imperialist logic of history where particular historical trajectories or events are understood as somehow expressing or being part of a more general pattern. And funnily enough, the general pattern here is based on the supposed trajectory of Western European and North American feminism. So in the wave model, it is a kind of very reductive and simplified version of Western feminism, if you like, that's being kind of made to stand for feminism as a whole. And so there's a presumption that there's a kind of inevitable feminist logic being worked out in particular local instances. So the idea is that feminisms everywhere have gone through the same kind of twists and turns, or if they haven't, that they kind of need to catch up or they'll get there eventually. And so in this way, I think the wave model does reproduce this kind of imperialist way of thinking about history. And it also really fails to get to grips with the kind of shifting material realities in which different feminisms operate, which have very different theoretical approaches, but also very different sets of principles and priorities and problems and so on. So it's imperialist, it's insufficiently materialist, and I also think it results in a kind of lazy historicism, where we consistently dismiss or don't take seriously particular kinds of feminism that we've kind of relegated to an outdated or bygone feminist past. I think Marxist and radical feminisms suffer particularly from this kind of treatment. So we often just presume that Marxist or radical feminisms will have nothing to say or nothing interesting to tell us in the present, because we presume so readily that they're kind of embarrassing and outdated. I was thinking, actually, there's a comparison here with the way that, you know, Jeremy Corbyn's politics is so easily dismissed as belonging to the 1970s. So rather than take his policies or his ideas seriously and think about what they might tell us or enable us to achieve in the present, we don't even have to take them seriously or think through them properly, because, you know, they belong to the 70s. But that's not what the Daily Mail wants us to think. But so it's this strategy, I think, of kind of relying on the temporal structure of the stories we tell ourselves about the past, rather than looking at the arguments themselves. So I think the quality of feminist argument is really impoverished by this kind of linear model of history that we continually reproduce when we tell ourselves stories about feminism and where it's been and where it's going and so on. So in response to these kind of problems, a lot of feminists have actually been calling for non-linear conceptions of feminism, non-linear representations of feminist history. As a way, I suppose, to be able to better recognise the kind of multiple lines of history and time that operate in the present, but also to forge a more, I hate using the word productive, but a constructive relation to the past. So rather than presume that the past is necessarily something that needs to be transcended or kind of moved away from, perhaps having a more hopeful relation to the past, where we might be able to turn to the past in order to inspire a more radical political imagination in the present. So this is an idea of a kind of looping back to move forward. But then I was also thinking of what you just said, what Nina just said, which I think is really important, about we also need to be very careful not to overemphasize the moving forward and the kind of positivity. And so I think, it might not necessarily be about looping back to move forward, but it might be about enabling ourselves to fail. my lecture said, you know, a freedom to be unhappy or to fail or to just kind of be a bit uncertain and rubbish. And I think that that's quite important, and I think
projection.
I'd like that freedom as well. But I think that if we stopped thinking about history as necessarily a movement forwards all the time, you know, it might be a movement backwards, but that's not necessarily such a bad thing. Mm-hmm. You know, we should be able to dwell in the past a little bit, or dwell in the present as well. I don't think we need to think of feminism so much as this kind of relentless mm-hmm. move forward. And I think thinking about it in those kind of terms is actually quite depressing and debilitating. So I think there can be something, you know, almost quite glorious about refusing the future or refusing to think in terms of forwardness. I think I'm going to stop there. I think you, Laura, said before something about the importance of this being a kind of interdisciplinary project, mm-hmm. and I really, really think that that's true, because, I mean, certainly when I first started thinking about these ideas, I was based in quite a traditional philosophy department. I don't know if anybody knows what they're like in the UK. But they're quite terrifying places, and when you start, you know, using terms like nonlinear history, you meet a lot of skepticism and raised eyebrows, and, you know, old men with the leather, you know, elbow pads kind of saying, what are you talking about? You know, this is against the laws of physics, and so on. And so I think for me, it became quite important to get a kind of conceptual clarity on what did it mean to talk about non-linear history. And so I found a lot of resources in phenomenology. And I was going to talk about phenomenology, but I'm not going to, because I think it's too boring for a nice art space like this. But, you know, when I then kind of met people who were working on similar ideas but from totally different disciplines, they weren't so hung up on the kind of conceptual questions that I was, you know, and they were saying, you know, for example, in literature, of course, time is non-linear, right? You know, you're always kind of flashing backwards and flashing forwards and moving around, and of course time isn't linear. You know, it didn't feel like such a kind of controversial project in a way, or people from film studies or from art, you know, there's so many resources, or we were talking before about psychoanalysis, but, you know, in psychoanalysis there's this whole idea that the past kind of catches up with us after the event. And, you know, of course,
but also that the unconscious has no time, yeah, history, you know, things are out of order.
Mm.
You know, there's just this kind of jumble in a sense.
Yes, so there's not that kind of foundational, or this presupposition of a kind of historical foundation that's always kind of moving forward, you know, one event serially after the other. And so I think, you know, if we look through all kind of humanities, social sciences, the arts, so many resources for thinking about history as non-linear, and yet there is this kind of persistent common sense idea that one thing happens after the other, and that history does move kind of inexorably forwards. You know, my students always have this presupposition of progress, you know, even despite all of the evidence to the contrary. There's still this kind of faith in progress. So I think part of the challenge is to kind of work with the resources you have in whatever field you're in. But I also think there's something recalcitrant about the idea of linear history. And I think there's so much investment in that. And so I think we also need to kind of think about the politics behind the kind of continual investment in this idea of progress in linear history. I think I'll stop there. Mm-hmm. Maybe we can all say things.
It reminds me, there's an Argentina, the sort of notion of sort of anti-progress, or after the crash, they horizontalism, this sort of almost non-hierarchical, sideways, mm-hmm. we have the resources, we have everything here, to sort of to halt progress for a while, and actually just sort of live in, be mindful that you live in the time that we're actually in with the resources that we have.
Mm.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's something that we also have to, well, I completely agree with what Victoria is saying, and that at the same time we also have this kind of fetishization novelty, you know, ideas always have to be new. There always has to be some, you know, and even if we think about kind of revolution or something, you know, there is a kind of fetishization of something happening, you know, something completely unexpected, you know, emerging, you know. But actually, I mean, the more interesting question, the more important question, I think, especially perhaps thinking about, you know, the resources of feminism is, you know, do the arguments still work? You know, are the concepts still relevant? You know, does patriarchy explain something? If not, you know, we move on with it, you know. But actually, the arguments that people were having in 1915 or 1970, you know, if they're still relevant, well, what, you know, then they're relevant. Do you know what I mean? Like, I think this idea that we always have to forget about the past, you know. But actually, when you go back and read these texts, you know, they're actually far more like trenchant and pertinent, you know, than we think. You know, this idea, this kind of arrogance of the present, you know, where we think, oh well, you know,
we've solved all the problems.
Of course, this is no longer. You know, it's ridiculous. I mean, you know, it does a disservice to the history of thought. You know, if we think about, you know, the history of human thought as a kind of resource in that a sort of general intellect, you know, of the species, very Marxist way of putting it, but, you know, actually, you know, things don't change that bloody much, you know. Actually, for all the, you know, newness and whatnot, you know, the problems are pretty much the same. Some of the suggestions about how we might analyse them are quite similar, you know. So I think it's interesting to go back to more, you know, and you know, things that are written a very long time ago, and think, well, what's here, you know, what can we use, what can we think about? And yeah, so I kind of want to critique the sort of fetishization of novelty and the arrogance of the present, as I'm putting it. And I think, you know, if we ask, do the arguments still work? Well, actually, if we're thinking about the question of time, so something like social reproduction theory, you know, the idea that actually, you know, what gets reproduced every day is the entirety of the social and all of the unpaid work that goes into that. You know, what does it mean to actually, you know, reproduce the world in its entirety every day, you know, to ensure that people are fed well, you know, are able to sell their labour power, you know, that people are washed and clothed and all these things, you know, the amount of labour that goes into constructing every day, you know, and that's an image of time. You know, and how do we reproduce what we want to reproduce without reproducing the negative things? You know, I mean, you know, sexism and racism are reproduced all the time, for example. You know, how do we reproduce ourselves without reproducing, you know, capital or these other negative things? And that, like, that's a really interesting problem for politics of time, I think. You know, because we're doing it all the time anyway, right? So we can't escape that logic. But I think if we pose the question, if we can see what we're doing in that sense, you know, the work of care, the work of reproducing ourselves and others is an immense labour, is what keeps the world going, actually. Then we have a kind of different model of time, not quite cyclical, but, you know, it's kind of revolutions and small sense. Maybe big R as well.
The concept of reproduction is really important.
Yeah.
And I was thinking about it when you were saying, talking about Firestone. So this idea of, or in the dialectic of sex that Firestone has. So she's writing at a time where, you know, the first test tube babies are just around the corner, and so it's this kind of
1978.
Yeah. Yeah. It's this time where.
She's writing 70, but 78 was the first.
Yeah. She's kind of looking ahead, and so there is that kind of sense of
absolutely
possibility of what could technology kind of bring, but particularly around the organisation of reproduction, and I think, you know, her thesis is so crude that, you know, actually, she kind of weirdly thinks that all oppressive human relations can be somehow kind of traced back to the kind of ultimate injustice, which is the female kind of role in reproduction. And you find kind of traces of that thinking a bit in de Beauvoir, actually, as well, I think. But in a way, I think this is quite interesting, because so they're telling kind of big stories about the history of human injustice and oppression. But I think also this idea of kind of the organisation of reproduction kind of being at the heart of human relations is also very present in utopian visions, where so often they're so, you know, it's such a conservative genre, because often what happens is the imagination is, you know, usually there's some kind of fertility problem, or it's, you know, like there'll be, for some reason, loads more men in existence than women, and so suddenly women are kind of once again reduced to this role. So it's kind of, there'll often be a device where it's like looking back to, you know, times before this, women, you know, there were all these kind of different ways that human beings could relate to one another, but now we have the kind of fundamental question of how to reproduce ourselves, and suddenly there's a very conservative and traditional organisation of gender again.
Or it's kind of buried and hidden, just as it is now, in a way. You know, it's like that which we may not speak of, but which subtends everything else.
And so I was just thinking about this, I've been watching the adaptation of The Handmaid's Tale, and it's like, because this is a dystopian projection, but, you know, again, it is, well, maybe not for everybody, but for me, it's dystopian. You know, again, it's women, or certainly the handmaids of fertile women, being kind of reduced to their role of reproduction. And I think, and in a way, it obviously performs a kind of critical function, you know, it makes us look at the present and so on, but, you know, in a way, it's so depressing to see that it's being played out again, you know, however differently it's valued. And so I'm really interested, I think, and this is why I think the interdisciplinary thing really comes in. It's like, you know, I just want to read a lot more feminist utopian literature and just see, actually, even if we think that there is an infertility epidemic in the future, you know, how might we resist that kind of return to it? Organisation, reproduction, where women aren't just reduced to a kind of childbearing function.
Yeah,
so
I think
I'd welcome any good things that people have read about that.
I'm just thinking, what that doesn't mention is if the infertility of the men.
Yeah.
How many of those towels were written a long time ago, so it's strange that they probably don't have any now. But I think the fertility of the men is an issue as well, which is sort of not really mentioned.
Yeah, so masculinity still functions as it did before.
I mean, so it's not really about fertility.
I read this book on somebody's recommendation last year. It's written by two evolutionary biologists called Sex at Dawn. Have you come across it? I mean, I haven't really had a chance to kind of really.
It's
like a great read over a holiday, but. It was arguing by looking at our closest evolutionary comparators to chimpanzees and bonobos that specifically around this issue of reproduction and it being something that's controlled in human society, is arguing that if you flip it over and say that the woman instead has all the power because she has multiple partners and thus you change the radically relationship between men and women. In that regard, so the men are all competing for her favor and there's the kind of model of thought around the kind of monogamous relationship being that the woman has to be subject to the male because the male's, it's based on the evolutionary conceit that the male needs one partner to you know, to reproduce his genes. Anyway, it's linked in a really interesting way to the relationship between nomadic versus sort of settled societies, and the writers sort of link it historically to the moment when people started to settle down and be linked to farming. And I don't know where this goes, but it feels connected up into capitalism in an interesting way, and capitalism. Needs sort of settled and organized and instrumentalized societies. It's really interesting to think about the role that women play within that. So I feel there was something really interesting I felt developing across your two talks. Maybe Nina and you talking about what was it? Because I was thinking about growth. The capitalism's dependence on growth, and maybe there being something that one could relate to women's the age of care.
Mm-hmm.
So if you, because in a way, capitalism defers care, whether it's to individuals or to the planet and so on.
Yeah, totally.
Into the future. So,
yeah, I'm very interested in actually what it would mean to start with care, actually, as, you know, because I think, in a sense, care as a value in the general sense of value, as opposed to value in the sense of profit,
yeah.
You know, because of course, I mean, care is absolutely, you know, fundamental to everything, but it's that which is kind of hidden, buried, treated very badly, it's gendered and racialized in specific ways, it's barely paid or, you know, unpaid or very badly paid. And yet, you know, because in a sense, if we start with care, it's acknowledgement that actually, for most of our lives, we're not autonomous, rational, you know, kind of profit-seeking beings, but actually vulnerable, dependent beings who are always in relation. You know, and our entire existence depends on, you know, vulnerability, in fact. And, you know, actually, if you start with that, then it changes two things that are very important to my mind, one of which is particularly relates to kind of current debates around automation and this idea of automating work. You know, that argument can only really proceed, it seems to me, if you have a very, like, already mechanised image of what work is, because you can't automate lots of things. I mean, of course, you can... you know, pretend to. You think about care robots, you know, I mean, these things exist. You can think about sex robots. I mean, actually, I'm in favour of sex robots because I think people won't have to sell sex. But, you know, but actually, you know, those kind of intimate bodily and personal relations, physical relations, I think we're not yet prepared, and I think there are huge ethical questions about this, to automate those, you know, and that actually to think that automation is the solution to the problem of work, the problem of labour, is to start from the wrong place. And the second kind of major point about care is it also changes how we might think about striking and how we might think about refusing, because it's very different, like laying down tools and sabotaging machines and leaving factories in the kind of classical sense, than it is to go on a care strike, because a care strike is, you know, about life, it is about vulnerability. You know, you can't leave your baby, you know, unattended and say, look, I don't really care, but if you want to. But you know what I mean? It's a very different question, and then that changes how we might think about politics as well. You know, I'm very interested in these forms of strike, that like the sex strike, and, you know, this is a very old idea. You know, there was the Icelandic women's strike, where all the women went on strike every single day and actually to change paying conditions in about 1974, I think, in a work. I'm very interested in smile strike, kind of Feinstein and others' proposal that women should stop smiling whenever men make shit jokes, you know. and these like emotional labour strike as well, you know, like not participating. And so the artists, Claire Fontaine, as a collective, you talk about human strike, you know, what would it mean to actually go on strike from our human capacities, you know, if all labour is increasingly kind of based around our capacity to be human, to be not, you know, to sell our souls and ourselves, if you like, you know, what do we actually refuse that work? So there's a kind of big question about, yeah, everything changes when you put care in the middle of a fundamental thing. I'm very interested in that, actually.
And that's, you know, these kind of speculative history of humanity would change drastically if you did.
Yeah, no, totally. Sorry.
If you did put care in the middle. Mm. But that's, I really like a book by a feminist philosopher called Christine Battersby, and she says, you know, what would philosophy look like if instead of the male subject, it was a female subject with the potential capacity to work, then how would that change our whole ideas about space and time and embodiment and rationality and relationships? I think, yes, so it could, it's a similar project in a way, isn't it? Where it wouldn't necessarily be a female subject at the centre, because there are potential problems with that. But yeah, it would just be the care actually at the centre. But just one thing relating to what you said is that I think we always need to be quite careful about drawing on perspectives from evolutionary biology.
Yeah.
I'm very suspicious of biology. You know, we remember that they're such stories, but they do such political work in the present. You know, thinking about, and again, often it's used to shore up a very kind of conservative
organisation of gender.
Bonobos are really cool.
Bonobos are pretty cool. This book attacked the way they were claiming that, like, Jane Goodall's research into chimpanzees has been, like, hugely distorted, and it was based on a really, well, obviously she was studying for a long time, but it was like, so interesting. So they really, they went back into her methodology, and it was quite convincing.
But humans are weird, because they are kind of oddly positioned between the aggression of chimpanzees and the affection of bonobos. Like, it's almost like a kind of choice.
But you know, yeah, what kind of connections you make or emphasise depends on what you want to say.
Exactly.
But I was thinking, because I had a baby about a year ago, and what I've really found quickly people draw on evolutionary biology to make just such
in general conversation.
Yeah, so it'd be like, oh, doesn't he look like his dad? And then so many people will then say, and that's because it's a way that nature has of telling us who the father is.
So people really say that
so much, so often, strangers as well. But we go so quickly to biological narratives to try and shore up a particular idea. You know, in this sense, this idea of a kind of patriarchal ownership of the child.
Yeah.
People seem to be really invested in it. I didn't realise we were so invested in it, but it seems that we are. But yeah, it's interesting. I mean, in philosophy and, you know, feminism, there is a surging interest actually in biology and what biologists might have, the kind of interesting things they might have to tell us about the human condition, and remembering that we are animals and we are kind of biological beings. But it's always just feels like a slightly risky thing to do, because the minute that you try and root feminism in a kind of natural science, I think you're fixing a foundation in a way, and then you say, what if the science changes to change our kind of theories about social relationships.
Yeah.
So I think it's kind of interesting, it's so inspiring, and then it also feels dangerous as well, so I'm not quite sure.
But it's a very difficult question, because I mean, if you think about the kind of wars over sex and gender, you know, actually, you know, what happens if you say that both sex and gender are constructs? You know, then you've got, you know, a kind of issue about them. Well, we can't talk about oppression on the basis of biology, we can't, you know. Do you see what I mean? Like, so there's a kind of maybe strategic essentialism, I guess, with the way it was discussed, you know, a few decades ago. And, you know, it's a very difficult question, because you know, like De Beauvoir's point about, you know, but since you can't choose how you're treated, you may want to be treated, you know, think of yourself as some kind of, you know, ether-like spirit, you know, sort of drifting around the world. But actually, if you're kind of constantly interpolated and treated in a particular way, then, you know, you don't have a choice about that in a way. And so you're constrained by that. And then it's kind of what you do within that framework.
Mm.
So very, like, very tricky. So, I mean, I really critique it, obviously, you know, some blunt, you know, poor uses. And they are always ideological implications of genetics or selfishness or whatever. And in a sense, you know, those theories of selfishness and possession, in a sense, probably make more sense of trace back to economic structure than they do to scientific development, you know, and they're often invoked then, they kind of reinforce themselves, you know. So, like, the selfish gene went along very well with Thatcherite and individualism, you know, there's total, you know, kind of mirroring and echo. You know, and I think you thought with this question of possession, you remind me there's this phrase in some languages where when you kind of speak to a woman, a man speaks to a woman, don't say, who are you, they say, whose are you? As in, like, who do you belong to? You know, who's your husband or who's your father? You know, and that kind of idea of being kind of, you know, being in possession, being something to be exchanged between men. You know,
it's about the handmaid's tale, isn't it?
Yeah.
The handmaids are named after the commander. And she actually said, I think, Margaret Atwood, that everything in the book is based on an example she found from real life research. So there's nothing in that book that hasn't happened.
Yeah.
So again, that's interesting, isn't it? The kind of drawing on history to project a vision of the present, just to bring it back to nonlinear history. drawing on kind of terrifying examples of the history to project a dystopian vision, rather than necessarily inspiring examples to construct.
constructive kind of utopia.
I was wondering, thinking about fertility and the mainly negative projections we have about control of fertility, whether you've thought about looking into one of the biggest controlled policies of fertility, which is China, and the one-child policy.
They've got rid of that now, though.
Yeah, they've just got rid of it. But only in the point of view is that all my presupposed ideas of what this actually meant to people when I went there, I've been there a couple of times, and I'm no expert, so I'm just positing this as something that might be worth looking at. The only thing I'd heard about were the cruelty, were the, you know, sort of obvious how we would feel about being controlled. But what I wasn't prepared for was how positive a lot of women were about it, about this idea, and how it seemed to have allowed for a freedom that a lot of, certainly when I had children, I had children, sort of a number of children, and certainly that felt like that was holding me back in many ways. How a lot of the women talked about it as a freedom, and they wouldn't want more than one child, and what would you do if you had more children? You couldn't do what, you know, in terms of work. And, well, I'm not saying that's right or wrong, but certainly my expectations were confounded by, and I was actually talking to urban women, so I wasn't talking to women in a country where I'm sure the experience would be very different. But again, it might be worth looking a little further about, there's a very controlled experiment, and how that was perceived by the people who were being controlled.
And I think that's exactly right, isn't it, in a way that we kind of have our presumptions, and actually, you know, the right thing to do is listen to the women that are kind of mostly affected, or might even be directing these kind of things.
But also, there will be no one answer. Well,
yeah,
answer,
as you say,
and within, I know certainly instances of women who have defied it and have suffered. They don't suffer punishment as such, but they suffer in ways, deprivations of education of the second child, of medical care of the second child. So these are very subtle ways of controlling. But nevertheless, great pain is inflicted. So it's no, there is no, as you say, no linear answer to any of it. But it is interesting to hear voices that I didn't expect to hear.
I think that's really important. And just to also think about, so when we think about the politics of reproduction, often from a particular kind of privileged white Western perspective, it often revolves around, you know, the freedom not to have children, and actually, you know, if you look at forced sterilisation programmes, for example, often the politics of reproduction from a feminist perspective have been actually a kind of fight for, to be able to have children. And so, yeah, I think place really matters, but also, again, not necessarily approaching these situations with a preconceived idea of what, you know, what's right or wrong, or how it will affect women, because often we don't know.
Anyone else
got any
questions?
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll move on to that was an extraordinary talk. Thank you. Lots and lots to think about.
Quite well, that's interesting.
Yeah, absolutely extraordinary. A lot to think about. We will be sharing it online. Possibly, if you email us, we have got through Eventbrite, not even. We can share it because we can kind of recap. And there's lots of things I'd like to read up and follow. That was.